If I say the boy is at rest, that's not completely true. And if I say the boy is moving or in motion, well, that's also not quite right. Why? How? All we know is that the boy is sitting inside a house. Now, if I go on to say the house is at rest, again, not entirely accurate. And if I say the house is in motion, well, that's not completely true as well. What's happening here? What's going on? Let's dig a little deeper. The house is situated on the surface of the earth, and we know the earth is rotating on its axis and revolving around the sun, right? This is how it may look if we look from the moon. So here comes the big question. How can we confidently say that the boy or the house is truly at rest or in motion? Well, we can't. Not absolutely, at least. We have to say that the boy or the house is at rest with respect to the ground. That's the key idea, because rest and motion are relative. We can say that the boy is at rest, yes, with respect to the ground. And we can say that the house is in motion, yes, with respect to the moon. Here, the moon and the ground are called the reference point, because rest and motion we cannot completely define without referring or to some other point. Let's look at another example now. We observe birds flying in the air, buses moving, cars zooming past, and trains gliding along railway tracks. So many objects around us are in motion. Now, when we sit inside a moving bus or a train, something strange happens. We notice that when it starts moving, the object like trees, buildings, electric poles, etc. seems to be moving. Are these trees, buildings and poles really in motion, or are they actually at rest? Now, when we look at from outside the train, it is clear the trees and the buildings are at rest and the train is moving. So again, what's really going on here? Who is at rest? Who is in motion? This happens because, yes, motion is relative. For someone sitting inside the train, it feels like the train is at rest and everything outside, the trees, buildings, etc. seem to be moving backward. But for someone outside the train, it's the opposite. The trees and buildings are clearly at rest and the train is the one that is moving. So again, we come to the same conclusion. From all these examples, we cannot define rest or motion without a reference point. Nothing is completely at rest or completely in motion, not on its own. Now that we have got that sorted, let's try to understand this a little bit more. What is motion really? All right, time to go split screen. Let's say we have a car at position A right now, and nearby there is position B visible on the screen. There is also a tree in a frame to give us some context. Now in screen one, watch what's happening. As the time passes, the car is clearly changing its position. It's moving from A to B, so over that given time, its position has changed. Meanwhile, in screen two, during this time interval, the car stays put. Its position, it's still at position A, even as time moves forward, its position doesn't change. That's the key. This comparison gives us a clear way to define motion. If the object's position is changing with respect to its surrounding in a given time interval, we can say that the object is in motion. And if the position is not changing with respect to the surroundings in a time interval, we say the object is at rest. So in this case, the tree hasn't moved at all with respect to its surrounding, and as the time passed, it stayed rooted at the same position. So we can say the tree is at rest, the car is in motion. Pretty simple, right? Yes. Now go ahead, try thinking of a few more examples around you. What's in motion? What's at rest? And that's the whole concept of rest and motion, always tied to the time and what you are comparing with, the reference point or the surroundings.